It's gone wrong.
We're on 25 gigabytes.
gigabytes.
That should be the show title. 25 gigabytes. No one's gonna understand that.
Because the show's not started yet.
I gotta mute Twitch. All right, there we go.
Yeah, that was starting to get on my nerves a bit. The weird reverb.
Gotta have that weird reverb. Gotta make it all spacey, atmospheric.
No one likes droning ass fucking music except for you.
So I'm like literally the only person that likes atmospheric music. Did you listen to the last Nebula Messiah?
No.
Because you don't give a shit about nobody but yourself.
No, I just haven't gotten around to it yet. Do you know how busy I've been with these motherfucking candles? This shit is taking up like a lot of
He's making all
time.
These candles for his satanic seances.
Mostly when I'm making documents, so it's not satanic yet. but there is a fragrance called Dragon's Blood, and I wanna get it just to have it. Dragon's Blood.
It's not satanic until after midnight.
It's one of those things like when someone says shepherd and like you want to go shepherd, shepherd all the time. And like nice. Those kind of things that are in video games,
speaking of that dude's voice, the moment you realize you guys don't really play Destiny anymore, the moment you realize that Banshee is the same guy that does Bender and Marcus and all them, he is full on Marcus as Banshee. And once I found out that he did that voice, I cannot hear Marcus. I cannot unhear.
Banshee is one of the quest givers, right?
Yeah, he's like the gunsmith guy.
Okay, yeah, I know he was one of the people at the thing. Yeah, you know, now that you say it, like it's like okay, cool. Like I hear that now. Kind of like the Bootsy Collins, the Bootsy Collins thing. Like when somebody says it, it's like, oh, okay, I get it.
Yeah,
makes total sense now. All right, so y'all ready to start?
Sure, go for it.
Let me clear my
Scott says he's watching before he has to go to work.
Oh, okay. He loves working that night shift shit. I don't get it. I don't think I can do it. I can't do it. All right, here we go.
Get it, Scar. Get it.
Well, I was about to, and then you started fucking talking, you dick.
Because I learned it from you.
I learned it from you, Scar. What's going on, everybody? It's your boy Scarfinger. This is Scarcasm, and we are live again. It's been a while since we actually went live because, like, no one was really watching us, and we was like, "What's the point of really going live?"
Yeah, it started when, like, I would have these internet problems, and then I'm like, "Why am I even doing this and fussing with this shit when nobody's even watching?" But we got watchers.
Yes, we do. Shout out to Scott.
I guess the internal term is viewers, but
yes. technically you have three viewers because both me, Scott, and Sam are technically all on watching, even though that we are on the show and I'm just there just to look at the chat just in case something happens.
Like that meme to where like you're like getting excited for your one viewer until you realize that one viewer is you.
Right. but that shit's kind of embarrassing though. Like when you post something on Facebook and like you realize that you like the shit by accident because no one should like their own posts. Right. Like, no one should. It happens. But no one should like their own post. But the fact that like, you might hit the button.
And then you forget that it's yours. You're like, oh, I like that. Wait a minute.
Yeah. You know, I got carried away when I discovered Time Hop. Time Hop had me all kind of fucked up because, you know, Time Hop, it does the, you know, the Facebook thing where like it shows you the shit that you posted like a year
Time
ago,
Hop
2 years
the
ago.
OG of that shit.
Yeah. So Time Hop, I discovered Time Hop, and every day I would go to Time Hop and be like, holy fuck, I really like what this guy had to say, but it's all my shit. So I was just like sharing shit over and over again. Like if you look at my Instagram, I was time hopping everything. Like I was just like, yo, I really liked when I said this. And like, I mean, some people say I'm self-absorbed. I say that I appear self-absorbed, but really I'm very self-deprecating inside of my head. But like, I was just like, I really like Time Hop as opposed to going back and listening to old shows, because I don't like to listen to myself. Like, I love what I have to say, but I can't listen to me. That shit bothers the fuck out of me. Like, I can't listen to me talk. But every time I do listen to me talk or like go back and look at old posts, I'm like, fuck, I like that guy.
Really? Because honestly, I'm completely the opposite. I look at myself and I'm like, I can't believe I said that.
You that one time that you like going off about white power and stuff.
Yeah, I was like, well.
Hey, yo, I probably shouldn't say this, but I had a thought earlier today. Because I went to lunch, and in the place where I went to get lunch, they have a news program on. And the news program on, it was breaking news. They captured 6 people in a militia in Michigan because they were trying to take down Big Gretch. Now,
wait, what's that?
Big Gretch is the governor.
Okay, I thought it was like a dude on the corner. Like, oh, what's that?
No, Big Gretch. They actually like made a song called Big Gretch, and some Detroit nigga made a song called Big Gretch about the governor, because you know apparently Michigan is very very Republican, but they have a Democratic governor. And so like all of this stuff was happening. They said that they caught these dudes. It was 6 dudes. And then it made me think, has anybody heard from Detroit Slasher lately? Because I followed Detroit Slasher on Facebook, and Detroit Slasher hates Big Gretch. Can't fucking stand her. Every day it was something, everything she did was like the worst possible fucking thing ever. And like the only thing that Big Gretch really actually did was do the thing she was supposed to and shut down everything so that we wouldn't get the fucking Rona. Like that's all she did for her state. But apparently no matter what she did, it was the worst possible thing. And like, he's the only person that I know of. He's the only like white person that I really that I know from Michigan. So like, I didn't know if it was other white people that felt this way, but like apparently they felt some kind of way, because you know when all of these we're not wearing mask protests and shit started before the niggas started protesting, you know, the white people in Michigan started that shit off. That big protest, they had a big protest at City Hall. They showed up in City Hall with fucking assault rifles.
I saw this on the news. Yeah, this was on TV.
Yeah, they showed up in the City Hall with assault rifles and shit, yelling at fucking security guards and police officers and shit. And like, and then like on the other side, pretend like we support the police and back the blue and all that other dumb shit. But. So and like they out there with like Confederate flags and shit like that, and I'm like, bitch, you live in Michigan. Like, why is there a bunch of Confederate flags here? But
what part of the Confederacy was Michigan?
Exactly. Was the Confederacy like, was Michigan alive in the Confederacy? Likely, okay. Barely.
I have 2 questions regarding this.
Okay.
Okay, number one is these are the same people who are like, well, we're collecting guns so we can overthrow the government one day if they ever get too hostile and blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. The same folks that are also telling everybody, no, follow the rules, listen to what the policeman says.
Of course, if you don't look like them. Okay. But apparently these six dudes decided to use their full Second Amendment rights to take down Big Gretch. That's all I'm saying.
Second question. Mm-hmm. Is Big Gretch related to Large Marge?
Likely. Okay. Cool. Yeah. Scott said that's how it is in Indiana, red state, but Indianapolis is so blue, so we voted a Democratic governor. That's pretty much how it is in Virginia now. Virginia is very red. Like if you look at an election map of like the different counties and shit like that, we are very red, except for Northern Virginia. And Northern Virginia has all of the fucking DC casts off. They all live in Virginia because, you know, DC ain't but yay big, and like the cost of living is a little bit cheaper if you go into if you go into Virginia from the DC area. So because they have the most concentrated amount of people, wherever they vote, we go. So like Virginia being a very, very red state for a long fucking time has gone blue for the last three presidential elections. So for a little while, they called us purple until the Trump election, where they just called us blue. We're blue now. And it's like, and it's like,
Scott, it must be Kid Rock fans.
Exactly. What Kid Rock claims to be from Detroit, but he's fucking from Romeo. And he's never been from the hood. His father owns a car dealership.
Canceled Kid Rock's two favorite words.
What's that?
The R word and the alternate F word.
Oh, which is really weird because Kid Rock has a black son.
He dated Midori.
He dated Midori. Oh, I found out something about Midori because they were.
Her sister Jodie Watley. I knew that.
Yes, I didn't know that.
That sounded really weird, Scar.
What?
I said canceled. The R word and the alternate F word, and you're like, that's weird because he's a black son. I was like, wait, what?
I mean, the R word. I'm just saying, like, just like the weirdness of Kid Rock, like for him be like super conservative hero now, and he has in like being seemingly very anti-black, but his oldest child is black. Which is fucking weird. Like, it is super fucking weird. But, like, and especially when he was going off that one time about Beyonce and was talking about how he basically said, I like women who look like white crack whores or like white meth heads. I don't like women that look like Beyonce. It's like,
he'll find all of those at the gathering of the Juggalos.
I don't really know much about the Juggalos, but it all seems like a stupid fucking idea. I don't know anything about it, so I can't really like judge it. But from the outside looking in, it all seems really fucking stupid. Like, am I the only person that thinks that the whole Juggalo shit is kind of dumb?
I think you're part of the 99% of the world there.
But the people who care about that Juggalo shit really care about that shit.
There was a thing where like Tila Tequila did a show at one of their Juggalo events, and they harassed the hell out of her and were trying to knock down her trailer and stuff.
Could she actually like sing or rap or whatever the fuck she was actually
doing? I really don't know what she was doing. This was a long time ago.
Well, but yeah, it's weird, man. I don't even know what I was going to say after the tea.
I don't know. We can move on and talk about our weeks, but before we do that, I want to say, can somebody find Detroit Slasher and make sure that he's not in jail? Please. I like Detroit Slasher. I do, but I know he got beef with Big Gretch. So
well, I was going to say that Big Gretch's campaign slogan should have been, "Tell them Big Gritch sent ya." Oh, I know what I was going to say about the joke. I bought Rage Against the Machine's first album. Well, I bought 3 Rage Against the Machine albums and the first System of a Down album from a kid, 9th grade, for a can of Pepsi. Because
now, was this before or after?
He was selling all his CDs for, he didn't care what he was selling them for, because he was wanting to not own any albums that weren't Juggalo related.
Scott just said he's a former Juggalo. He said it's dumb.
Now, was this before or after Rage Against the Machine went political?
Yo, speaking of that, did y'all see this shit about Wolfenstein?
No.
Yo, somebody from the Wolfenstein team.
Oh, they barely realized it's about Nazis?
Yeah, made a post and it was like, "Make America Nazi Free." And white people started losing their shit about them being political and stuff like that. And it's like, do you even know what the fuck Wolfenstein is about? It's about killing Nazis. It ain't never been about nothing else.
And how is that statement political? When has that ever been political?
I don't know, because like at the end of the day, when it comes to the Nazis and the Confederates, we've literally had wars about this shit, and we were on the good side of those wars.
They were called the Allies for a reason, not the Axis. You can tell which ones are the good and the bad guys.
That shit is just kind of dumb. Like, yo, how do you, I mean, Wolfenstein is about killing Nazis. Like, that's the whole point. Like, the whole point of the whole fucking series is about killing Nazis. So when someone says, "Make America Nazi Free," it's in brand, dog. Like, what is wrong with y'all? Like, people are fucking stupid.
And Wolfenstein is very patriotic.
And it's about killing Nazis. What's more patriotic than killing fucking Nazis?
Right.
Eating hot dogs and waving the American flag.
That shit's stupid. That shit's dumb as hell. All right, so.
Where you wait at?
It's been a few weeks since we've done a show. I know we did some extra stuff because I know we said we were going to take September off, but we did some extra stuff, and that was cool. But I really enjoyed my weeks off. Now, the only thing I've really done, I watched some TV. I play very, very little when it comes to video games, and then I've mostly been concerned about making candles and wax melts. Like, I don't really have much else to talk about except for that. Like, I did watch a show. I watched 3 seasons of a show. I watched 3 seasons in the show of a show in like 4 days.
Jeez Louise.
Yeah, I didn't really do anything else but sit there and just watch the show when I was not at work. So yeah, so we can talk about that, but like, I'll start. My weeks have been pretty fucking cool. My, you know, it's more about like still dealing with work stuff. Work stuff slowed down again a little bit, and it's weird because again, like when work slows down, then I'm thinking maybe I should pull out my Nintendo Switch that I haven't used in months, and then it just never kind of happens because every time I think about it, then the phone actually rings and I'm like, well, fuck, I gotta answer the fucking phone now. So it never actually happens. So still, I haven't turned my Switch on in months. But other than that, and like trying to help my daughter with her school stuff and all that kind of stuff, man, it's just been fucking normal for me. How about y'all? Sam, I'll let you go first.
I'm a little bit disturbed by Scott's admittance that he has 3 Juggalo tattoos, including one on his neck.
You really got to be about that life if you got one on your neck, dog.
Dude, protect your neck is about Scott.
He need to protect his neck from Juggalos. That is the show title: Protect Your Neck from Juggalos.
From Juggalos. Actually, hey Scott, how much Faygo have you drink? I bet he drinks a lot of Faygo.
All right.
I see his response. Go ahead.
No, it's on you, dog.
My week has just been filled with going to work and coming home and playing games and watching a little bit of TV, but not too much. I haven't watched a whole lot this week, though. That's pretty much it.
Okay.
I've been actually looking at this interesting thing online on YouTube. Have you all guys heard of the Sonic statue in Japan?
No.
No? Chase, have you heard about this?
No.
Okay, a long time ago there was these things called Sega World. Sega World was like a bunch of like basically just Sega stores, but like mega big, they looked like malls. A lot of them were in different places, like there was one in Australia, one in Japan. I don't know if there was one in the States or not, but I do know that one in Japan closed down. And at the center of this big store inside was a huge Sonic statue where he's on a surfboard. So at some point the store closed and they took everything out. Maybe around 2009 or so, 2005, 2009, a blog post showed up on a Japanese blog saying I was driving my bike down like the highway down like a road in Japan. And as I was driving my motorcycle, I noticed a huge fucking Sonic statue on a surfboard.
Okay, so it was just out somewhere random?
It was just randomly out in the middle of like the forest in Japan, where you know how like there's the forest and then there's a road and you just go down the road. It's really deserted, really isolated. You really have to know where you're going in order to get there. Or so just it's like, passing by.
It's like one of those places where you need GPS coordinates to get to
it. Basically, yeah. So nothing came of that. It was just a random throwaway blog post. And then 2018 or 17 or I forgot what year, someone else saw it. They were like, yo, I've seen this big-ass statue. And he took a picture of it. No one had taken, the guy before had not taken a picture of it. And it's legit to say it is the statue from the store, but in the middle of a road in Japan. So they did research on this. Someone finally realized that what happened was that someone who worked for the owner of the building that big mega Sega store was at actually took the thing with him. Dragged it. I don't know how he transported it, but he took it back to... Apparently what happened was people were having a hard time finding a house. You all right there?
Yep.
People were having a hard time finding his house. So what he did was he put that thing out in the middle of the field and said, here, when you see this, my house is behind it.
Wow.
So don't die with her, Chase.
When you see the big ass Sonic on the skateboard, turn left.
Basically, pretty much. If he was in Detroit, he would have said that. But no,
right, because apparently Detroit is like that now.
Yeah, they do. Like 2005, I knew I had a friend that lived in Detroit, and she said there was nothing but rednecks around her.
I don't understand that. I don't understand how rednecks made it to Detroit. How is this possible? How did we go our whole life thinking that Detroit was not in the South?
So anyway, so
I mean, okay, so like in the last like couple of years, I just realized that Michigan is in the Eastern time zone. So maybe that's a thing. I had no idea that Michigan was in the Eastern time zone.
Well, the time zones are weird. They're like, there's things that been think and that should be central.
Right. So anyway, so that happened, and then so people, oh yeah, they would not, the person who found it would not give the coordinates because they didn't want anybody to go over there and fuck it up. So they're like, nope, I'm not telling you where it's at. So for a couple of years, no one knew where it was. And people would just randomly drive around roads in that area of Japan, and no one could ever find it. And finally he said, okay, you know what, I'm just going to put the GPS coordinates, the latitude, longitude here. And people little by little started going there, taking photos with it and stuff like that. This thing is huge. This is a huge statue.
I'm about to look this shit up, yo.
Yeah. Sonic statue, Japan. Sonic on a surfboard, Japan. So anyway, so people started finding it and going over there, taking photos with it. Over the years, the thing has deteriorated to where it looks really bad. It looked really bad for a long time. And then recently, a few months ago, someone drove by and they're like, it's been restored.
Yeah, I just see the, I literally just see the video because I searched it and I see the video and the video just says the Sonic statue has been restored. Like, I just saw that exactly when you said it.
Yeah, because for a long time it was just like, it looked like crap.
There's an article. There's an article on Polygon about this shit.
Because it had been sitting there for years, you know, getting rained on and all kinds of elemental, the weather had been crapping all over it, basically.
Now it's all fucking shiny.
Because that thing had been sitting there for like a good 10, 15 years.
Well, I have a picture on the stream and it's like it's in the woods.
Yeah, exactly.
That's crazy.
So yeah, that's what I've been researching in. Recently, they tried to do a GoFundMe for the people who own the statue now. They're like, no, that's fine. We don't need it. They told people to just, hey, don't try to mess with it. Don't try to climb up on it. Respect the statue, and just like try to be safe when you're taking pictures because people stand on the road, and that's a busy road.
Well,
that's the only two things they asked for.
Well, good job, Sam, and your new position at R&D. We hope to have some good.
Yeah, you totally fucked that one up. Like, what? He was being sarcastic, and then
he lost it
and lost what he was saying. Wow! So it's been restored, and no one knows as of August. No one knows how it got restored. Who was behind?
Oh, no, there's a video. There's a video that show pictures. Because like one of the people who does YouTube videos actually reached out to the owner, and the owner showed him photos like, here, this is what we did, here. So yeah,
so someone on Polygon didn't update their shit.
Yeah, but again, this has happened. This was in the last 2 days or so.
Okay.
So like, I guess Polygon hasn't gotten wind of it yet.
They put the restoration part up. They just didn't. They said that as of now we don't know who actually restored it.
Yeah, it was the owner, and owner got a bunch of people together, and they all restored it.
Okay,
word up. I just think that's really cool. Like, I'll never go there, only because like not only is it in Japan, it's in a desolate part of Japan to where like you really need to know where you're going to get there.
Word.
There's this one dude online who said he went there, and he said it cost him like $100 taxi ride just to get there. After taking a 2-hour train trip and then getting a taxi ride for $100 just to stand there for 5 minutes.
Yeah, you're right.
RoboCop has a statue.
Yeah, RoboCop has a statue in Detroit. Like, they couldn't put a statue of a motherfucker that's actually from Detroit. Or Barry Sanders, at least. RoboCop, like, come on, dog.
RoboCop is from Detroit.
Why is there... There better be a Barry Sanders statue somewhere. Anywhere. In fucking Detroit, as opposed to just having a fucking RoboCop statue. Like, there's some people from Detroit that deserve statues. Fucking make an Eminem statue. I don't give a fuck. Why you have a RoboCop statue?
Wait, is Barry Sanders actually from Detroit, or did he just play
there? He is not from there, but as I understand it, according to Jemele Hill, when he retired, he stayed.
Oh, okay.
Does RoboCop be shooting dicks off and shit?
Jeez.
What?
No. So, what do y'all want to get into first? Y'all want to do games, or we want to do what you're watching?
It's whatever. Chase, you pick.
Scar, you pick.
Okay, games. I'll do games. So, I got a hankering to play some Killing Floor the other day. So I grabbed my disc because I actually have a disc of Killing Floor on the Xbox. And I put in my disc and I'm like, hell yeah, I'm about to play some motherfucking Killing Floor. And then that shit said, we have a 28 gig update. And I'm like, well, I guess I'm not playing this shit today.
Was they updating the significant, or was it just like
behind the scenes? Well, they add things pretty much every season. They add new maps, usually like one new map and at least two weapons. And now they've been doing like two free weapons and two DLC weapons. But like if if you don't have the DLC weapons and you're playing in a match with someone who does, you can actually use the DLC weapons. So every season they do a big whoop-de-doo and they add these things and like changes and all that kind of stuff. But it's been a while since I played, so I'm guessing that 25 is like a whole lot of stuff because it's been quite a while since I played. It's been quite a while since I played on Xbox. But yeah, so I didn't get to play that. I did get into a little bit of the Division. They did an update where if you have Warlords of New York, they added a new mode where you have to go through 100 levels of what was supposed to be a skyscraper of some sort, but it's kind of like bullshit. But it's just basically like floors, and it gets increasingly harder, and then they throw in like weird shit that you got to do, like objectives and stuff like that. In the course of going up this skyscraper, in every so many floors, the difficulty goes up. So by the time you get to the top, you're on like legendary difficulty with all of like the hardest people to get to and all of that kind of stuff. Like, I played a little bit. I think I'm through. I started from the beginning, and I think I'm 240 maybe, but I play on slightly harder stuff, especially when I'm playing with my cousin or whatever like that. But I'm not un-Nepo enough to make it to 100. Like, I don't think I'm ever gonna make it to 100. Like, unless I'm with
100 is the new cap now.
No, 100 is the floors of this.
Oh, okay.
This thing, this mode or whatever. So I don't think I'm ever gonna make it to that. Unless I'm with like the rest of the team is just basically carrying me like a teddy bear book bag. So like, I don't think I'm ever going to make it there, but I mean, for what it is, the mode is actually pretty decent. They're still tweaking and stuff like that. So apparently everything seems to be working. So
you actually go up floors versus waves.
There's waves on each floor. there's the
waves on multiple floors.
Well, that mode actually seems like it would actually make the name make sense. You're actually going up the killing floors.
I'm talking about Division, dog.
So you thought you had one right there.
Well, I switched and I said I wanted to play the Killing Floor, but I had that update, so I had to play Division instead. Oh. You just totally whiffed on that. Yeah.
No, he locked onto his joke, and then nothing.
Yeah. Said after
that. It wasn't a joke. It was like I was like, "Hey, wow, it's actually living up to the name."
We need a soundboard of Mills Lane saying "swing and a miss." we need a soundboard of that.
We do need a soundboard.
I thought about this that road podcaster like really highfalutin whatever like that, but that shit is like $500, and I'm like, everything that I wanted to do to like upgrade or whatever like that, new camera or like a new mixing board and stuff like that, everything I wanted to do was $500. Like, nothing, there was nothing less than $500 out of the things that I wanted to do to improve my situation here. And like, the Patreon ain't making no money, so like, I can't really put that into anything, because the Patreon at this point is not even covering the hosting costs. So yeah, there's that. I forgot to mute my Googles. But yeah, I played that, and that was cool for what it was. And then I played a little bit of Madden. I played the same face of the franchise mode. It's Madden.
Was it Madden?
A lot of people.
we've had weeks off, man.
Yeah. So you're just trying to cram all of this dumb shit in right now, like right right now.
Like, dude, it's what
right
I
now,
do.
Right now, Chase.
Just like, let me do now, what I do.
He okay, is.
Stop. I am strong. Yeah. I'm independent.
A lot of people do think Madden is maddening, and it's not a very good game. I don't play it enough to really call it one way or another. I think Scott would be the one that would really be able to tell you whether it's a good game or not, because he's the one that plays every day.
I mean, regular football is basically Madden right now anyway.
Not necessarily, because they starting to get hit with that Rona, so like people are missing time and shit. It's gonna start getting bad. I wonder why the fuck they decided that they were gonna bring football back without a bubble in the first place. That shit seemed dumb to me, but oh well. And basketball's about to end. It's about to be summer of Bron again. Well, is it some? It's not summer of Bron no more because it's not the summer. So it's fall of Bron. No, we can't call it fall of Bron because we don't want Bron to fall.
Autumn of Bron.
Autumn of Bron. Autumn of Bron. But the basketball has been pretty dope. I don't really watch the games. I've just been kind of watching the highlights, and it's really like interesting stuff. But yeah, I played some Madden. I'm playing my face of the franchise character. I really hate how that character looks, but I also don't want to put the time in to make him look better because I'm not going to spend that much time in the game. I'm still on my little 10-hour trial on EA Access, which in about a month from now, EA Access will be included inside of Game Pass.
Game Pass Vanilla or Game Pass Ultimate?
I think it's Ultimate. I don't know if it's in vanilla, but I know it's.
It's not in vanilla right now because I'm living proof of that.
But it doesn't actually come over until like the 11th, November the 11th, 7th, something like that. So it doesn't actually like do that. And then like if you have time on your EA Access, they're going to credit you some money towards your Game Pass. So I keep suggesting Anthem as the game we should play. Give it a month, we'll all be able to play Anthem. Just give it a month. I kind of want to play Anthem because I never actually gave it a chance. Okay. And since I played a decent amount of Destiny 2
What I played in the beta, the gameplay, I actually kind of enjoyed the game.
Yeah.
Just there wasn't much of a game outside of that. And right. They didn't give it enough time because most MMO light games, you know, the gameplay is the main thing. And then they kind of build. That's the whole thing. It's a living world. It's supposed to build. So the initial thing is going to be shitty. But you just have to keep with it. And EA did not keep with it.
Yeah. I think all of the games as a service games are pretty much the same. Like all of them except for that Marvel shit that they just came out with. Apparently that game is fucking horrible. Like it's really horrible. Let me tell you how they're trying to monetize this shit. Each character has its own separate battle pass to pay for.
Wow.
I heard that it wasn't that bad, but maybe I'm just hearing it from people who bought it and are trying to justify their purchase.
That's what it sounds like.
He has it, but I haven't asked him if it's any good or not.
I've heard that it's like it's buggy as fuck. Like I'm not saying like a lot of people say that the framework is there for there to be a good game, but like it's buggy as hell. The microtransactions are ridiculous, you know. Like in the microtransactions, like if this was a much better game, this might be excusable, but it's not. So it's not. But yeah, I mean, because of how much I've put into the Division, apparently I care about games as a service games. And initially I put a bunch of time into Destiny 2, until the expansion started coming out, and I just didn't want to put no more money into this shit. But a lot of the expansion content is in Game Pass now, so you could do that shit too.
Yeah, and now they've pretty much gone to this yearly thing to where there's a yearly expansion. And then everything else is just through pass.
Yep. So Shout out to Game Pass. Yo, Game Pass is the shit. That's the Game Pass is the probably the number one reason why I want the Xbox over the PlayStation. Mm-hmm. It's like Game Pass just seems like a better value for somebody like me. Like I would never want to pay for Two Point Hospital on the fucking Xbox, but it was there and I played it and it was really fucking fun to me. So like, you know, like that type of stuff, that's the reason why, that's how Game Pass shines. And like, the holy fuck, if I would have paid for Gears 4, I would be fucking furious. Like absolutely fucking furious. But because it was on Game Pass, when I actually made it back to it, fuck it. It was like, it was on Game Pass. I ain't paying nothing extra for it. So like, fuck it. Gears 4. Fine. You know, like that type of thing. That's why I care about the Xbox more than I care about the PlayStation. All right. What y'all got? I know, Sam, you said you played a little bit, right?
Yeah, I played some Dead by Daylight with my girl and her peeps. And it's interesting. Just put it that way.
You said what'd you play?
Dead by Daylight.
Oh yeah, I know people who really love that game. One of my homeboys
you
that
watched
I know from
you play that during a game night.
Yeah, I did. I never actually made it into the game. One of my homeboys who I know from like the marching band community, he has his own YouTube channel, and that's the only game he plays. Like, he doesn't really play anything else. Like, every once in a while, it'd be something else. But that is, like, the only game he plays. And like, he streams that shit all the time. And I'm just like, what is it about this game?
I mean, it's fun when you're with friends, but I would not play this with randos. It just seems kind of pointless with random people.
Why? Because no one's going to try to help each other?
That and just, like, there's just no... I mean, a lot of it was just, like, the jokes and stuff, like... The cracking up, like the whole, like, where are you? I'm gonna go find you. I'm gonna beat you till you're half dead, and then I'm just gonna let you bleed out. Dumb stuff like that, you know.
I'm gonna stab you in the stomach and skull fuck your corpse.
Because the skull is in the stomach.
I'm gonna stab you in the stomach to kill you, and then skull fuck you. Like, I don't want to skull fuck you while you're alive. That seems really weird. And more gooey. At least, like, I'll let you die and then let it congeal a little bit.
I'm not going to skull fuck you while you're alive. That's just rude.
that's just mean. Why would I be mean? I'd at least kill you first. like we're not unreasonable here. No one's going to eat your eyes. Like, that type of thing. Like... I still love singing that song on Rock Band. Shout out to Jonathan Colton.
So you played anything else other than Dead by Daylight?
Oh, I actually started playing Jedi Fallen Order.
Did you like it?
Well, I got to like, I'm past the tutorial stage, and I'm just like in the other stage. I think the last thing I did, there's like a room with like a sphere. Got like a bunch of fans, like a little bunch of turbines, and I have to like shoot them down with the force. It's pretty good. I mean, that's where I'm at now. Where I just got out of that part. No, it's pretty fun. I see a lot of Force Unleashed in it, like the way he moves and stuff like that.
Well, a lot of people were turned off that it's not a hack and slash game. It's a game to where you're more of a strategy. I mean, I don't consider it a hard game. I just consider it a game that you can't just run around hacking and slashing.
I think most people called it basically Jedi Souls.
Well, see, I'm
sure if you could put it on the higher difficulties, it would be hard. Just like any game would be hard on the hard difficulties, but it's not like Dark Souls in the fact that it's difficult. You do have like the campfire type thing where you start back at a certain point or whatever, which is like the campfires in Dark Souls. But I don't think it's as difficult. But you definitely can't be like hacking and slashing. You have to like parry.
You can't button mash your way through that.
I'd say it's more similar to like how like Assassin's Creed Origins.
Is that the one I couldn't get past the beginning?
That's the Egypt.
Oh, okay. No, what was the first one that was on Xbox One?
The one that nobody liked.
No, but no. Black Flag was a port. That one didn't count.
The one where you're in France.
Oh, Unity.
Unity. Let me tell you about Unity. I'm not a fan of sneaking. We've said this many times in the show. I tried to play Assassin's Creed Unity. You know, at the very beginning during the tutorial stage where you show up to this palace and you got to figure out a way to sneak inside of the palace? I couldn't get inside of the palace, so I put the fucking thing down and I've never been back.
The second one starts out with, like, you have to race your brother across, like, rooftops. You know how long that took me the very first time I played it? Almost like 30 minutes. And that's the very first thing you do.
You said in two? I think I actually made it pretty decently in two, and then I had the whole Groupon fiasco with two.
Oh, because you were doing it from the GameFly, or?
Yeah, I was. Yeah, the whole Groupon thing. I'll explain it for the people who don't know. I got it from GameFly, and I was like, I kind of like this. There was a Groupon deal where because I played it way after everyone else, so like they had a Groupon deal where they had two Brotherhood and was it Revelations? Or am I talking about the Matrix?
Maybe we're in the Matrix. I don't know.
Oh, Brotherhood and Revelations.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. So, yeah, Matrix. So they had a Groupon deal where I could just buy that for like $20. And I'm like, cool, I'll send this shit back to GameFly. I'll have to start over because that deal was I was playing on Xbox, but the deal was on PS3. And I was just like, fuck it, I'll just start it over on PS3. It was cool. I got pretty decent. I was all right with it. And then the Groupon shit took like 2 fucking weeks to actually get there. By the time the shit came from fucking Groupon, I didn't even want to fucking play anymore because it's been 2 whole fucking weeks. And I'm just like, I don't even fucking care anymore. Fuck that $20 or whatever the fuck it was. It's just like, fuck that money. I just basically pissed on $20 or whatever it costs. And now my PS3 is broken, so I can't play it anyway.
But no, I did get some Assassin's Creed out of it just because of the climbing that you had to do and all the wall scaling. So no, I mean it's a pretty good game. I mean, I'm gonna play it as long as I have patience for it. Because once I just lose all like, oh whatever, screw this game, I'm not gonna pick it back up, I don't think.
You don't get like too worried about 100%ing maps because you're going to go back to like there's certain things where you're like, how am I supposed to get over there? You're not supposed to. You'll get a power to where it'll allow you to do that.
Did they ever add that game to EA Access? Because it was not.
They said they were at one point, but I don't know if they ever did.
Okay. All right, cool. Anything else for you?
Animal Crossing, pretty much. That was it. The Jedi Fallen Order was... No, Dead by Daylight was the first time I turned my Xbox on in months.
You know something that I've... One of the YouTubers that I watch, he plays primarily a lot of, like, PC games, but a lot of, like, city builders or, like, tycoon games or just stuff like that, like Motorsport Manager and shit like that. He did this video where he was, like, really, really excited for the video game version of Caucasian, which the rest of y'all know it as Carcassonne. But he was like really fucking excited about like they finally made a video game out of the board game. It was like we've been had this on 360. They gave it to us for free. What are you talking about, dog? But I guess since he's on PC, he's never paid any attention to that. But he was like really, really jazzed about the PC version of Carcassonne. And I was just like, where the fuck have you been, dog? They gave this shit to us for free. And me and my friends, we used to play that shit all the time when we you know, one of my friends called it Caucasian, and like we all just kind of started calling it Caucasian.
Yeah, you played that when you had to take a break from Hexic HD.
Hexic was dope.
Doritos Crash Course.
Doritos Crash Course is still the best. The second one, not so much, but the first one was fucking dope.
Which is the one with the dinosaur? I forgot.
That's Crash Course.
Okay.
Yeah, the Crash Course was fucking dope, and it's fun. Like when you have a bunch of your friends in, and you're all playing at the same time, that shit is like that shit was like super fun. It was like, what fucking Scar? Like he's way back there. He keeps falling in the water. Like that type of shit. Like that shit is like super fucking fun. And like you don't have to be hardcore about that shit. What was the other game that they came out with the fucking? It was a, like the race car game, but there was also like turrets and shit. And like it was like you're like half of your team is racing in the cars, and the other team is like jumping from turret to turret trying to shoot everybody else. It was another one of those games that they gave away for free around that same time.
I don't think I played that one.
Yeah, I played it with some friends at the time when it first came out for free. It was fun for a little bit, but it wasn't anything that was...
I do remember 1 vs. 100.
I loved 1 vs. 100.
That was my jam right there.
I loved 1 vs. 100. I actually became the person only one time, though.
Really?
I actually became the person one time, but I loved 1 vs. 100. They should totally do some shit like that again. And like,
didn't they take the thing from that game and make it something else?
I'm not entirely sure.
I think they said they would, like the whole, they took the backbone of that and made it into it. Or they said they were going to take the backbone of that and make it something else.
Yeah.
It became Battle Royale.
Did it really change, or are you just being funny?
It's basically the same kind of idea, right?
Yeah.
1 vs. 100 is basically Battle Royale with trivia.
It's even Battle Royale Tetris.
Yeah, that one was free on the if you had the online thing. I've heard people really get into that. Elaine was talking about playing that and being really good at it.
Oh, it's Tetris 99?
Yeah.
On Switch?
Yep. I haven't played it. I downloaded it when it first came out, and then I don't use my Switch, so
I can't. Yeah, I played it for like a minute, and I was like, "Yeah, I don't get this," and I just turned it off.
Yeah, I think the biggest problem that I have with Switch is I really wish I knew somebody who knew how to like physically go into a Joy-Con and switch those fucking buttons around. That would be like being able to like just change the software to which button is which is one thing, but being able to physically change the buttons would help me so much in that game, because it's not like it's the A button that functions like the B button. No, the A button still functions as the A button, but it's not in the A button spot. Sorry.
Yep.
All right, what you got, Chase?
Yeah, I played some of that Among Us with guys from Bad Fodder Figures, and it's all right.
That game looks like fun.
Yeah, it's pretty fun. Yeah.
I played it too.
But I mean, it's cool, but I don't understand how it's so huge. And I think there's probably, you know, some like major streamer streamed it and then made it all funny, and then everybody wants to play it because they did it. Because
didn't they give it away on PlayStation Plus?
It's on mobile.
I think it's the Rocket League effect. They gave it away on PlayStation Plus.
You're thinking of that Battle Royale game called
I thought Among Us was on PlayStation Plus also.
It probably is.
I know what you're talking about. The other game where you got to go through the obstacles and shit.
Yeah.
I can't think of the name of it, but I've seen people play it. I actually watched. I discovered something about a week or so ago that is like the greatest thing ever. T-Pain is a Twitch streamer.
Oh yeah, I heard about this.
And there is a video of drunk ass T-Pain playing Among Us with a whole bunch of just randoms. And the other guy was streaming. So he captured all of this, and it's just like drunk T-Pain, having the time of his fucking life fucking around with these white people. And it's like the best thing ever. T-Pain is fucking hilarious. Like, it's like fucking hilarious. And he's like really compelling to like listen to. I watched, there was a stream where he's like composing a song. And he's composing a song from the very beginning. The first part of that shit where he is composing his initial part of the song is 7 fucking hours. Jeez. And I watched a good 5.5 to 6 at work. Just bored at work. Like, I ain't got shit else to do at work. So in between, like, and then, like, he would just go off on tangents and, like, play the Bobby McFerrin World Song Day video or some shit like that. That shit is compelling as fuck, yo. Bobby McFerrin is a fucking master of the human voice. Bruh. If you've never seen that shit, I gotta figure out what it is. Hold on. Is Bobby McFerrin just in a fucking, it's just, he's just on a stage by himself and he's just, and then eventually he tries to get the crowd into it. But like the idea of like that guy, the don't worry, be happy guy is a fucking master of the human voice is like really fucking cool.
You know, there's a lot of people who think that's Bob Marley.
What?
The don't worry, be happy. People think it's Bob Marley.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Even though it sounds nothing like him.
Wow. That's weird. Yeah, it's the Sing Day of Song by Bobby McFerrin. There's also another video that I watched of Bobby McFerrin when I was on that train. And I know I just totally hijacked the show. So we'll get back to Chase in a second. But there's a video where he does a thing where he is like explaining how people interpret music. So what he does is he jumps up and down, and like if he jumps up and down in this spot, it is this note. If he jumps up and down in this part, it's another note. And he starts jumping around, but because of our connection with music, we understand which notes are supposed to be next. So when he goes above or below where he had already started, we all kind of like interpret, we all like subconsciously interpret the different notes on the pentatonic scale. And it's like the most amazing thing. And he's just, and at the end, he just kind of talks about how like, no matter where he does that, anywhere around the world, everyone seems to get that. And it's like really fucking cool. It's like some way music nerd shit. So I'm going to stop talking now.
But yeah, also been playing Divinity Original Sin 2 with my brother and a buddy. And that's pretty cool. When we first started, my brother had it on classic. He thought that was the normal difficulty. I was like, no. As a second from the highest difficulty.
Ooh.
And we were getting murdered. And I was like, I remember playing the first game. I don't remember getting murdered like this. But it's a turn-based game, but it's not like a JRPG. It's more like a classic RPG. It's more strategy, I guess you would say. Because we would be like, okay, I'm going to go behind this guy, see if you can use that one thing over here. All right, it's my turn in... So it's like a co-op thing, but you each get a turn to like strategize what you're gonna do, and it's really fun. And,
yeah, my man, Corey from Starting Point, he is all about that game, and like him and a friend had a streaming series of them playing that. All the time. So I have an idea about the game. It just didn't sound like it was anything for me.
Right. It's as close in a video game, I think. I mean, other than Baldur's Gate, but I haven't really played any Baldur's Gate before. But to me, of playing pen and paper RPGs as actual pen and paper RPGs and not playing the actual D&D licensed games like Baldur's Gate, I think this is the closest that you're going to get to that. Because there's like powers like oil. Like,
Well, didn't those same dudes just come out with a new Baldur's Gate?
Yeah, they're coming out with Baldur's Gate 3, and it is co-op too. So since we like this so much, we'd probably really like that. So,
word up.
But and I'm also playing through Resident Evil 5 with Fred Rojas and
my nigga Rojas.
Resident Evil 5 is a game that I absolutely hated when it first came out. And then I was like, well, there's a lot of things that I didn't care for, and I've been kind of revisiting some things. Might as well revisit this. And I've heard it's better, 100 times better when you're actually playing this co-op. But the AI was horrendous, and I guess still is. And it didn't have a good start for us, but we actually got in there. And actually, AZ Rockslide joined the Discord chat, and we were talking with AZ for a while. That was pretty cool.
Word up. So, I know I never played it, because I've never played a Resident Evil game after I tried to play the first game and I shot all of my bullets and people still kept getting up. And I was like, fuck this shit. So I've never played another Resident Evil game, but I know I ended up buying it for Sherry when she was a co-host on The Pimp Show.
Yeah.
And I know she played through it, but I don't know anything else about it. Like, nothing.
Well, it's more fun with a co-op person because the AI was absolutely bad. But even on Steam, like, it took me a while to get it started because it still wanted to do games with Windows Live, and Fred had to get me to a website to, like, disable that, to, like, put something in the game file or whatever. But once I did that, that worked fine. But
they said when you play by yourself, she's basically just a walking storage closet, right?
Yeah, but she's using all your shit. Like, she'll be, like, fucking shooting shit when you're not needing to shoot shit and just, like, using... I mean, it's still a Resident Evil game. You're still having to, like, conserve things.
I don't know what a Resident Evil game is like, sir.
Okay, well, it's a game that where you're not trying to, like, just waste resources. Oh, it's a resource management game. Hey, you play those. Well,
yes.
Think of if you were playing one of your resource management games, but the AI is just using all your shit.
There's a new one that's coming out that I think is kind of dope, where it's like it's a city builder, and it has kind of like things like Banished. I know y'all don't give a shit about Banished, but it's kind of like Banished, but it has a lot of elements to Civilization in it also. So, like, you start in a certain area, and then you start building up, like, a tech tree and going through different ages, and also, like, using, like, money or influence or something like that to open up new areas to expand your cities, and you can have, like, subsidiaries and all that kind of stuff, like Civ. But that seems really cool, but it comes out, like, the end of this month. But there are some, like, YouTubers playing it right now, and I'm like, I can't wait to play this. But then again, I don't know if my computer can actually play this, so maybe I should calm the fuck down.
What's it called?
It's called Kingdoms Reborn. But yeah, it seems like it's really dope. But then again, I'm also the same person that bought Civ 6. Well, you gave me Civ 6 for PC, and then I bought Civ 6 for the Switch. I've never actually played it.
Yeah. And the rest is I got back into Destiny 2 Halloween event.
Of course.
Still fun.
No one surprised. Not a soul. All right, so
I got a Mindbender's Ambition scar.
Okay, so I'm just going to talk real quickly about some things that I've watched. I'm only going to talk about
it was remakes. Masterwork scar.
I'm going to talk about three things that I've watched. I'm just going to ignore Chase at this point. Okay, so randomly, well, no, I'm talking about four things. For my birthday, I decided I wanted to treat myself, and I rented the most recent Jurassic World movie.
Mm.
It was just okay.
I really disliked it.
It was just okay. It wasn't great. It wasn't like the worst thing ever. Like, it wasn't three.
It wasn't three, yeah.
It wasn't three. Like, that's like the only thing, right? That's like, you know, like when you talk about like Star Wars movies and you're just like, it wasn't Phantom Menace. Like that type of thing. So
you
like,
talk to a new Star Wars movie, it's like, I miss Phantom Menace when they were good.
Yeah.
I have so many memories, nostalgia phantom memories.
Squeak prequels. Fuck that. But it wasn't like the worst thing ever. It could have been better. Apparently they're making another one, and I'm like, how the fuck are you making another one? But you know what? I guess they're gonna figure the shit out. But as I understand, the new one, Chris Pratt is out. So yeah. I think I'm out. I think Chris Pratt was probably one of the best parts about the most recent Jurassic movies. So, yeah, about that. But for some reason, they convinced Jeff Goldblum to come back again. He's only in the last movie in like...
He's like in there for 5 seconds.
Yeah, he's in there for like a couple minutes, and it's like courtroom scenes where he's just basically...
No, it was like... In the trailers and everywhere, they were like, star Jeff Goldblum.
He should come back. He should come back in Jurassic Park, but he is dressed and acts like the character in Ragnarok.
You know what? I think that could work. I think it would have made if he was in these courtroom scenes dressed as that character, it would have made that much more interesting.
it'll be T-Rex versus champion.
That was pretty decent. Like way of the manner of speaking. About a week or so ago, I decided. I've heard people talk about these movies a lot, and I've never seen them. So I rented the Kingsman movie. And I thought the first one was fucking dope. I thought it was dope as fuck. I enjoyed the shit out of that movie. I'm like, yo, what? I say, why didn't y'all tell me about this? But like, people have been telling me about this for a very long time, and I've just kind of ignored it. Just kind of like, what the fuck? But like, I really enjoyed these movies. I'm like, yo, if I would have known that I was going to actually enjoy it, and I like the second movie, even though like it suffers from sequelitis. But if I knew that I was going to enjoy it so much, I would have took my little Google money and I would have just paid for both movies at the little $20 Google pack where you just buy the fucking movies. I would have just did that instead of the little $4 to rent it. But I enjoyed that movie so much that the next day I rented the other movie. And I didn't like it as much, but it was still cool. It was all right.
I take it you don't like the movies, Sam?
I saw part of the first one. I was like, this is ridiculous. This is too much.
It's like if James Bond and Harry Potter had a baby.
Oh, God.
It's basically like you go get, you know, Harry Potter, who's just like an absolute fucking nobody, and then you bring him into the spy version of Hogwarts. Like, you know what I mean?
Spy warts.
Yeah, spy warts. Bond warts. It was just really cool. I really enjoyed it. And the scene in the church was fucking great. It's just like long shots and I really like the action of that movie, and I like the fact that there's a lot of parts of it where it didn't take itself too seriously, but a lot of people I guess got bent out of shape about the thing that happened at the end of the movie.
Long shots.
Okay, so does anybody care about spoilers?
No.
Okay, so they were kind of playing on the James Bond trope. Spoilers for anybody who don't want to get spoiled, just fast forward a little bit. They were playing on the James Bond trope about like how at the end of every James Bond movie he finds a chick to fuck, basically. So like, there's this princess lady that's being held captive. And he's talking to her, and he is in a sticky situation, and like, he gets out of the situation, and then she was just like, can you let me out? And like, he's just like, no, I need to go finish this, and I need to save the day. And then she goes, well, if you save the day and let me out of here, I'll let you fuck me in the ass. And like, And basically, at the end of the movie, he goes, figures out a way to get into her cell, and then you see like him, like through a, I guess, a camera through his glasses or whatever. You see him getting ready to line up on that ass, and then the movie cuts. So like, I mean, okay, it was just kind of funny, like a play on the James Bond thing. But I guess a lot of people felt some kind of way about it. But fuck it, it was funny to me. But yeah, I really like the movies. I think you should try to watch the whole movie. If you go in thinking like James Bond Hogwarts, you'll be fine. Kind of like Superman Returns. Someone tells you it's a bullshit love story, and you go, "Oh, okay, all right, fine." That type of thing. And then I watched a TV show. I watched a 3-season TV show in 4 days, and that is a TV show called Travelers. Travelers is a very weird TV show. I spent the whole first season trying to figure out what the fuck was actually going on. And I was really just trying to like, what the fuck's actually going on here? And it's basically some people from the future, right? Apparently the future is really far. Why the fuck would you say that in the recording, dick? But apparently the future is really fucked up. And so they come up with some sort of artificial intelligence that is helping them survive in this future that was fucked up. So they come up with a plan and they figure out how to send their consciousness back to people in the past so that they can try to, so they could try to fix the problems that are going to lead them to the future that they came from. But how it starts out, they jump into a person that they know is going to die because they actually have an exact time and place of death that's trackable by the AI. But they can only come back to like now time because you have cell phones and stuff like that that can accurately put someone in that place so you know exactly where they were for this. So someone is about to die in the original timeline. This person dies, but they get a consciousness from the future downloaded into them right before they die. That person prevents the death from happening. It's usually prepared in advance. So like if I'm in a car that's about to explode, like, okay, so now I know how to get myself out of that when, and I got seconds from the time that that is about to happen before I can, when I jump in there, I got seconds to prevent this death from happening. And then I have to go on living this person's life. But then also you have the part where they don't really know these people. They can, because they're going back to like a time like now, they can only go by the information that they know from like their public records, Facebook pages and stuff like that. So like if someone has inaccurate information on like their Facebook page, like this person is going into someone else's body thinking that that Facebook page is accurate, and it is really not. So then they have to figure out how to live their lives, but also be accountable to a team, because they usually go back in teams. Like you have a medical personality, you have a leader, a tech expert, a tactics person, you know, like that type of thing. This is usually about, I think it's a 6-person group. And there's all kinds of cells around the world. And what they do is they just get these missions from the AI in the future of how to prevent shit from happening. And it's just really, it was just really interesting. Like I said, I spent the first season trying to figure out what the fuck's really happening here. But I really fucking enjoyed it. I super enjoyed it. I don't think that they're going to make any more. I think it got canceled, but I enjoyed what was there, and it's on Netflix if anybody wants to watch it. And what have you watched while we wait for Chase?
For the first time ever, I've watched The Thing You Do.
I love that movie. movie. I love that movie. I bought the soundtrack.
It was kind of, the story seemed kind of sudden. Like the ending, like the whole breakup and everything, that seemed like it was just out of nowhere. Like the dude's, his gripes.
I quit.
Like it, all his gripes, everything just seemed to come out of nowhere. He never mentioned any of that stuff that he wanted to do. Like he might have mentioned it once, mm-hmm. but it was never really brought up again. And then it was just kind of like, wait, that happened out of nowhere.
So, so after watching this, do you get the Hey Ya video now?
I never paid attention to that either.
The Hey Ya video is basically is that thing you do, and then like the part where they go through, they show you the different characters, and of course he's playing each different character, and it's like sorry ladies, he's engaged or some bullshit like that. Like all of that is in the Hey Ya video.
Oh, okay. Yeah, no, I mean it was an okay movie. It was kind of.
At the time,
it seemed to go by too fast. That's what I'm saying. Like they tried to scram as much as they could in the hour and a half, and it just seemed sudden.
Yeah, I think it was is one of those movies. I think it was it suffered from for me as a black person. It suffered from not quite being Five Heartbeats level. You know, because the Five Heartbeats was based off of some real people. I don't know if this was really based off of real people or just a story that they told. Because, you know, like the Five Heartbeats was based off of the Dells, and like it has a little bit of Temptations in it, but it's mostly based off of the Dells. So like they had a wealth of information to draw from in order to make that movie. And like it going back to some Dell stuff, going back to some Temptation stuff, and they could just pick and choose what they want to make a decent little movie out of it. I think that thing you do kind of suffers from, it doesn't have that kind of direct line to something that happened for real to me.
Well, I looked on the Wikipedia and they said that like a lot of what they were doing was trying to mirror like the Beatles.
Okay.
So I don't know.
But you're right. I probably as an adult now, I probably would look at it a lot different than I did at the time. But yeah, I absolutely love that movie. I bought it on DVD. I bought the soundtrack on CD. Like I really like that fucking movie.
The woman who was actually Tom Hanks' real life wife was in it. She was that waitress, that older waitress.
It's been a long time since I've seen it, so I probably won't remember no random waiters.
She was in it for like the last part. Okay. She was with one of the guys, the one who was talking to the jazz singer. She's the one who's trying to get him to go talk to her.
Okay.
So anyway, I'd seen her before on Frasier and stuff like that, but she was looking good in this movie. I was like, wow. I had no idea she had it like that. I just thought she was just a random woman.
Yeah, sometimes you can see a glow up. It's a glow up, especially if you're watching something in the past. You're like, wow. Like it's kind of like how my girl was watching some TV show. My girl was watching some TV show, right? And in the TV show, Pam Grier plays in the TV show. But like Pam Grier now is old and she's not Pam Grier. Like she's old and she's a big lady now and she's not Pam Grier. And it was really weird when I was in the room and that was on and I just kept thinking, that's Pam Grier. Why is that not Pam Grier?
She was in the movie with Tom Hanks recently, a few years ago, Larry Crown. And I was like, is that Pam Grier?
Yeah, and then when she played in something else. One of the CW shows or something like that. And she was new Pam Grier. She wasn't old Pam Grier.
Okay.
And I was kind of like, that's not the Pam Grier I know.
I'm Pam Grier.
Oh no, it wasn't one of the CW shows. She was in Smallville. She was Amanda Waller in Smallville.
All right, let's see. What else did I watch? Oh, so like a long time ago, there was like a movie that came out. Well, I knew about it because a buddy of mine was like had a cameo in it. Mm-hmm. It was filmed in 97, but it didn't come out until 2002. It was called The Gamers. It was like literally shoestring budget. It's about these guys who played D&D in a dormitory on like finals night, disturbing the hell out of everybody. And you get to see them in the game world as their characters that they're playing. And it's a fun little movie. It's just a random small movie. The main joke of the movie is like this woman who keeps having to come to their room to tell them to knock it off is the princess in the fantasy world that they're trying to rescue. I just thought that was kind of funny.
It's kind of like that show. What was that shit called? The Guild?
Yeah, but it's D&D. It's not like a MMO.
Right.
Yeah, but it's like that.
Yeah, but the whole time that they're actually like physically connected to this person that they're trying to digitally save.
Right. Yeah, that's kind of what it's like. So then they made a second one in 2006, which some of the same actors, but they were playing different characters. I noticed that. So, and this one had more of a story, and they actually went out in the real world. They went to the comic shop, they went to the coffee shop, they just hung out in the actual world. And then they also had the fantasy stuff. And then they made a third one, which was about like the card RPGs, you know, like Pokemon and stuff like that. And they went to they actually filmed this at Gen Con, or one of the cons. And it was like a whole big, it was a big to do and everything. They filmed this big scenes and everything. Chase, you all right? That was like 2010 or 11, I believe. And then nothing after that. There was nothing else after that. Nothing. Literally nothing.
Okay.
And then they started coming out with these little web series, but they wouldn't finish them. They would only come out with like one or two episodes. There was one that was like Dungeons & Dragons, but it was called Humans and Households, which is basically D&D characters from the fantasy world are in our world.
Okay.
And like they're playing D&D in our world with a game called Humans and Household. A bunch of them have like you could pick your race or your country, or whatever. Most of them pick American. So at one point they're pinned down by something, and they're like, "Wait a minute, I forgot we chose Americans." And so they all pull out their big guns, and blah, 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 blah. Except for one girl who didn't. And they're like, "Where's your gun?" He's like, "Oh, I chose Canadian for the charisma points, and also the healthcare. I think like her medical was up or something." And like it was funny. It was basically fantasy characters like a barbarian and this and that, but in our world. But we're actually transported into our world to play like a jock or a nerd. Like that, like this big sword, this big swordsman. Or yeah, swordsman gets transported into a skinny woman, nerd woman, named, her name was Bill Gates version.
Wow.
So that was like a web series that they made.
Okay.
And then nothing until a few years ago, they actually made a fourth film. So this fourth film has like the most story out of all of them.
Okay. Well, okay. You got to speed it up because I got to give Chase. We got to get Chase some time before I leave.
Oh, Chase walked away. Okay. Yeah, so
Chase walked away. So, but now he's back. We got to actually pretend that we want to actually hear what he has to say.
All right. Look at this. So okay. So this one has the most story in it. It has like, it takes place. Oh.
No, my belly says we're live.
Hey, hey, hey! You'll get kicked off the Twitch for that. So anyway, so
not for dudes.
Oh, yeah, for just too.
Texas.
So anyway, so it goes back in retcons the first movie. Not retcons, but add something to the first movie. So they're showing in this fourth movie, at the end of the first movie, some wizard goes into the room where the D&D players are playing and traps them all in like a energy thing or whatever. So in the real world, these four players disappeared in 2001 or whatever, 2002, whatever the game takes place. And so there's some people, just some random ass people who are trying to unlock them from their gaming, from wherever they're at in the game. And they have to play as these people. It's weird. It's like a weird, it's a whole convoluted story, but they're basically trying to take these players out of the game. And like, These are just regular people who were actors in 1997. They did not age well.
And they went back
and got the original dudes, and they did not look good.
So somebody decided to take this and add a little bit of new Jumanji to it. All right, I got you.
Yeah, it was like the original four players that were in that first movie, and yeah, now they're trying to break them out of wherever they're at. But yeah, it is the actual same four actors. They do not. Wow, that's bad.
Yeah,
but
they age like Pam Grier.
But no, it was a fun movie. Like, I hope they make a fifth one because they didn't actually finish.
Okay.
But yeah, that's what I watched.
All right. Oh, before we get to Chase, I want to say there's a show that I want to watch. And it follows the theme of like that we just been talking about for the last few minutes about nerd shit. Have you heard about the show Utopia?
No.
Okay. So it's an Amazon Prime show. And it's about these people who inherit a house and going through the stuff and getting rid of the stuff from, I don't know, it was a grandfather or some shit like that. They find this comic book series that was, and apparently the person who owned the house worked on this comic book series. And the comic book series is kind of prophetic. And like it predicted a lot of shit that happened in the world. And so like a lot of people were like, is like based off of like Comic-Con and like conspiracy theories. And like everybody's trying to get their hand on this comic because it's a sequel series to this thing that a lot of people have read a lot into about it being like prophecies and all of that kind of stuff and like interpreting everything. So these people who don't know anything about this decide to take it to like a, this world's version of a Comic-Con to try to see if they can sell it. And then like there's like assassins that are trying to keep people from getting at this and like all kinds of like weird stuff, but it seems rather interesting. And apparently there's some sort of truth to the comic books because one of the main characters from the comic book kind of shows up at the end of episode one. But like, you know, like, so it seems like it's really interesting. I watched the synopsis of the first episodes, so might find out exactly what this shit is about before I decide to spend 8 hours or whatever the fuck watching all of these episodes on Amazon. But it seems like it seems like it'll be really cool. All right, Chase, you got it.
Yeah, I haven't been watching anything. I was gonna do that whole thing to where did the horror movie thing, and then I got really good over the weekend. So I was thinking about if we could have the show up by, I was going to have it edited so everyone can know that today is Thursday. So tomorrow I was going to do one, then go in.
You're not going to give any lead time?
It was supposed to start last weekend and supposed to be every Saturday. Okay. So tomorrow I was going to go ahead and make up the camp. That was with me.
Okay.
So yeah, and I'll post it in the, because the list of the movies.
Candyman seems like it would be really fucking corny to watch now. Like it seemed really fucking scary then. Like it was like real hood scary then, but it seemed like it was really fucking corny now. So it might be interesting. We'll see how it goes.
Well, I heard that the projects or whatnot that they were shooting at was like
Caprini Green. That it was a real project. Yeah.
Yeah, like some, most of the people in the background were not like paid actors.
Yeah, they did. They did a lot of that on The Wire too. A lot of the extras were people who actually lived in those places.
Yeah.
And then, like, the character was her name Snoop from The Wire.
Yeah,
she was just one of them. It's like she wasn't an actress. She was just one of them. But it was just like, I kind of like you.
You can kind of tell who was and who wasn't only because you never saw them again in anything else.
Exactly. because all of the actors, you've seen them in something else.
Yeah,
I've seen Senator Davis in so much shit. Like, I've seen Senator Davis in so much shit. I've seen Senator Davis in a lot of stuff. And
yeah,
The Wire, I've seen.
After The Wire ended, the guy that played the mayor, not the first one, but the white one, he popped up on Game of Thrones, and I was like, "Hey, look, it's the mayor."
Yeah, that's the young dude. He was really young in The Wire, but wasn't he like a eunuch or something like that in
Game? No, he was basically like a hustler, kind of in the way. Like he had his hands in everybody else's pocket. Yeah, he had his hands in all kinds of pockets.
I thought he was a eunuch in Game of Thrones.
No, the eunuch was like the bald dude.
Okay.
This dude is like a hustler. He's basically a proprietor of all sorts of businesses. He has his hands in all kinds of jars.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So do the Candyman, and then on Saturday will be Tremors. And then it'll be every week.
Tremors, the further you go with Tremors, the worse it gets.
that's a lot with a lot of movies.
But Tremors got really bad.
And Tremors 1 and Tremors 2, there's a huge leap, because Tremors 1 was actually like a well-made film, or like it looks really nice. Tremors 2 looks like it was like some kind of college drama, club with a camera.
Right.
But the budget just died.
Yeah. It's one of those things. I can't call it. All right, so are we done here?
Pretty much.
All right, so we actually got a pretty decently long show out of this. I'm proud of myself for actually staying interested this whole show. That's a happy very often, and it's probably because Chase didn't have very much to talk about, so that's good. But thank you guys. I don't know what I'm going to do. I thought about doing some other like side stuff in addition to like videos about like the candle stuff, because and there ain't really much I can say about it here that anyone's gonna give a shit about. So I want to record more videos, but the problem with the videos is, unlike the paintings, the candle process of like making this shit is mostly the same thing over and over again. So like, how the fuck do you make compelling videos when you're in the early stages and you're just making stuff and testing stuff and, you know, that type of stuff? Like, maybe once I actually start getting some stuff sold and like add new products and all of that kind of stuff to the line, maybe that might be more of a thing. But I'd still just really kind of want to talk about it. So I might just pop on the microphone one day, just kind of sit here for a few minutes and just kind of talk about my experience, because I think it's really interesting, but I know a lot of people who are probably listening to this probably don't think it's very interesting at all. So there's that juxtaposition, and I feel sad. Yep, just in that moment, the realization made me feel sad. So stay tuned for that. At the very least, I'll try to record something, put out a video, but I'll also make a little mini episode and kind of put that up. You can listen to it if you want to. I could talk about my process and what I'm doing and how much I enjoy this. So that's coming. Other than that, I think that's it for us. Are we going back to 2 weeks now? Is that the plan? Is that the plan? All right. So we'll see y'all in another 2 weeks. Make sure that you're registered to vote. If you don't want to vote for me. I can't vote. So like, please go out there and vote. Not that I'm a felon or anything like that. It's just like problems with my address. because I live above a business and they classify this as a business and not a residence. So I can't register to vote with this residence because it's not a residence to them. So I'm stuck and I can't fucking vote. So vote. Do your thing. Do your part. And like, if you can vote, then that means that you can complain about some shit. No matter how this goes. But please do that shit. So peace out to the Warriors. We're happy to be back, and we'll be back in your ear holes, making sweet, sweet whispers to your ear hole in 2 weeks. Peace out to the Warriors, yo.
Peace.
Existence is meaningless, and we're all going to die.
I like that shit, yeah, boy. Yeah, I'm telling you, Walt. I'm telling you. All right, I ain't gonna talk.
That kind of would have worked out a lot better if you could have correctly pronounced meaningless. You kind of slurred through that like you were drunk. Like, it's like you tried to say judicial system. You always sound drunk when you say judicial system.
It sounds like jujitsu system.
See, you always sound drunk when you say that. Shout out to Dana Carvey. That was on an old Dana Carvey special. But you always say drunk when you always sound drunk when you say that.
Nice. Alrighty, I'm about to go. I have some things I have to do.
Yep, me too.
See you later.
I got some food. Peace, brother.
Bye.
That's later. I got to sit on my hands for a little bit and go left-handed, so it feels different. I hate myself for that.
We've been live this whole time.
I hate myself for that. Oh, that's just a bonus to anyone who watches this live. but yeah, I captured everything, so it's all here.
All right, so you'll send the drive, and or are you going to edit?
No, I'm not going to edit. I'll start recording, and I'll put it in the thing now.
Okay.